Okay, we're back. We're live. It's Monday. You know, it's been a really interesting weekend. And I learned a lot this weekend, got a lot done. I'm not sure. Maybe it was the water. But it actually worked out this weekend. How do you like that? And it's working out today. Here we are in the early show, 10 o'clock rock, with Cyrstal Kwok. That rhymes. 10 o'clock rock, Cyrstal Kwok. Say hello to the people.
Hello, Hawaii. Hi,
it's her debut, right?
Here? Yes, it is.
Yeah,
it's exciting.
We are going to explore here on ThinkTech Global Kwok Talks, because Kwok Talks is not limited to today. Kwok Talks has a brand already in Hong Kong for years and years. We'll explore what happened and what Cyrstal did there.
Okay. All right.
So let's start with the beginning. You did not, you were not born and raised in Honolulu, nor were you born and raised in Hong Kong. You were born and raised...
A little bit.
Okay, mm-hmm. Tell us.
So I was born in San Francisco, and I moved to Hong Kong when I was three. Lived there for about 6 years, and then came back to the States, and then I almost finished school. During my third year at university, I had a chance to go to Hong Kong, and so I went and got a film contract with Golden Harvest, had a two-year, four-film contract, and then I ended up staying. But then I finished my four films at the first year, and I thought, I have one more year before I graduate. I'm not going to ruin that. So I came back, finished my degree, and then I went back, and I thought, okay, I want to be a filmmaker now. And then I went into the production side, and I stumbled onto the entertainment. And actually, I was there for the entertainment industry, but then I ended up going into my talk show and my, post-production and all the other types of...
I want to unpack that a little bit.
Okay.
So how do you walk into Hong Kong and get a contract like that? How do you do that? You knock on the door and say, hi, my name is Cyrstal.
Yeah, it doesn't work that way.
How does that work?
No sleeping couch, none of that stuff. But
I never said a word.
Well, this is the reality of some places. But I hate to bring this up. I hate that you asked me this.
Sorry.
But I got a free trip over because of a beauty pageant. And I hate talking about it, but that's the ticket. No. That's how I
see. I'm a deft
it.
Interviewer, and you know about
you
that.
You made me. You pulled
made,
it out of
I
me.
Pulled, all right. And I even know it. Now I know. Now they all know it.
Yeah. Now they're all going to be judging me.
So you got this contract. This was easy. What did you do under the contract?
Okay. So my first two films were with Jackie Chan. And it was fun.
I saw that in the article.
Really? It's at that?
Our Vice President, Carol Mon Lee, looked you up, and this popped up. And this is from the Jewish Times in Asia. And I said, what is it, a confluence, an intersection of some kind?
Yeah, what's
and they're
the deal?
Writing you up in this long article about you.
Yeah.
And it's in the Jewish
I'm
Times.
I'm more Jewish than my husband.
Okay.
I do my Shabbat sometimes. I buy the challah bread. I make the best chicken soup.
I love that. Years, many, many centuries ago, there were 10 tribes, mm-hmm. And there were 12 altogether.
Right.
And 10 of them got lost. They're called the Lost Tribes of Israel. And some people firmly believe
the Chinese.
Yes.
Kaifeng.
You've heard this before.
I want to do that as one of my stories one day, the Kaifeng Jews. It's really interesting. 2,000 years ago. Yeah.
I knew there was something to
we
it.
We might have some path before we can trace that we're related.
And that's why they came to you. They knew there was something there, the Jewish Times.
They smelled it. Yeah.
Okay, so Jackie Chan. We got to hear about Jackie Chan.
Well, it's funny because I grew up half in San Francisco, and when my dad used to go to take me to Chinatown to watch all the kung fu films. So I grew up watching him, and then lo and behold, when I get over there, my first two films is with him. Small parts, but I got the stupid beauty queen title, she gets to do star in this one. And I was a very opinionated, still am, opinionated, self-confident college student who thought I could, rule the world. So I get in there in my first film, and I was his legal assistant. He was a lawyer. And they dressed me in this short mini skirt, and they permed my hair. And I was like, day two filming, excuse me, Mr. Chan, but I don't look like anything that works in the law office. And he looked at me like, who is this girl?
Upstart.
Yeah. So he brings me in the room with his big producer, and I'm like, I'm not comfortable wearing this, and I don't think it fits my character. So they talk, and then next day filming, they give me a long skirt, glasses, and a file. So if you ever look at the film, you can see the difference in the two things, and it just goes to show if you open your mouth, sometimes it works.
Yeah. I'm sure they appreciated that.
Well, no.
No, maybe. They wanted the short skirt.
They were tickled by it, but yes, they liked the short skirt. And I still wear short skirts now, but it's okay. It's my choice.
You still talk to Jackie Chan?
Well, when I do see him, yes. Actually, we have an interesting relationship because he's the one who supported me for my film when I produced my own film way back,
too.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, okay.
Was great. So he said to you one day, Cyrstal, why don't you make a film?
No. Actually, because I was interested in filmmaking before, I would follow him along all his post-production. You know, when they do the... they do the dubbing and all the sounds and effects and editing. And I would follow because I was a college student. I had nothing to do. A first year out there. And I just followed the whole pack along and just learned from them. It was fun.
Great. Okay. What was the film you made?
The first one?
Yeah, the first one.
It was called Dragons Forever. It's one of these Chinese New Year's films where they have three big shots that were always in them. Sammo Hung, Jackie Chan, and Yuan Biao. And it's an action film, obviously. And it was just a fun little, I was a kid and it was fun to be in a film.
How did you set it up? You had a backer, maybe Jackie Chan, maybe?
No, because I went there and I had signed with Golden Harvest because I had several
they
interviews.
Backed it, so
they put me into this film.
Oh, very cool, very cool.
I guess so.
And the film was in Cantonese?
Yes. So when I moved there, my Cantonese was pretty choppy. You know, I have my father's from Hong Kong and I can speak it a little bit, but after being in San Francisco so long, it was choppy. And I hung around with all the stuntmen, you know, Jackie Chan stuntmen. And you know what they would do, as any stuntman here or construction worker would do? Teach you all the wrong words, right?
You got to know that, though. It really helps.
Yes, I guess
so. You don't necessarily have to use it, but you have to know it.
But those are the most important words to learn first when you learn a new language, right?
You're right.
But I didn't know which words were appropriate and not appropriate. I never learned the scientific words for things. I only learned the slangs. So I got in a lot of trouble for my talk show when I come to that later. And it wasn't because I was trying to be controversial. It's because I didn't know any better.
So what was the plot of this Cantonese film that you made?
This Dragons Forever? Come on, do Hong Kong films really have plots? Have you ever seen an action film? I know I'm mean, but it's true.
I never saw it. Well, Jackie Chan has plots of a sort.
Yeah, they have. It's fun. They have silly things. There's a bad guy, and they have to kill him or beat him up. And they have all of the stunts.
You take forever, beat him up over and over.
Yes, I learned a lot of
stunts.
You wonder
how you survive, but then you back up and do it more.
That's right. I learned to do a few stunts.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I was in Police Story 3, which was one of his other old films. That was my second one. And I learned how to put out a cigarette butt with my hand. So they just iced my fingers. And I had the scene where I had to they cut it out of the film, of course. I took it from this bad guy and it went, because I was like an undercover.
Well, this is getting pretty interesting, actually.
Yeah.
So you're learning Cantonese better. And
learning the bad words better.
Learning the bad words. And then now somewhere along the line, what, there's more films? Or did you go into television and radio?
No, not yet. That stuff didn't come until second phase.
We're going to do this systematically.
Okay, so film time was, two with Jackie Chan. And then I did others with some other companies. And I was on a roll. Honestly, if I had stayed, I might have been a big star. But I left, I said, I remember my last day of shooting before flying back to the States to go back to school, there was this top actress, her name's Dudu Cheng at the time, she's number one. And we were playing cards waiting around the set and I'm leaving and she says, why are you giving this all up? Aren't you gonna regret it? And I had none of that thought because it's like, no, I wanna finish school. But these people are professionals and they work and that's all that matters to them. And so, you know, that's their world and I was happy to leave it.
Yeah.
But she was right. I lost that momentum. I came back, I got my degree, I studied more film, and then I went back to Hong Kong and I had to start all over again.
Oh, because nobody knew you? Why? The connections were old?
No, it was only 1 year. But you know how things are. When you go on a roll, you have a run. You have some luck or something that's going with you. And if you change that momentum, things can change.
And you got to start again.
Yeah, it's like throwing craps, right? Sometimes you get a good run and then sometimes you go, okay, you better not play this round.
And I know, now I know.
I don't gamble.
You remind me of Zhang Yi.
Zhang Yimou?
Yeah. No, not the filmmaker, the actress.
Oh, Zhang Yi. Really?
Yeah. What's her name? Something Yi. Was Yi Zhang Yi?
Yeah. I'm drawing a mean blank. But Zhang Yimou's.
Yes, right. House of the Flying Daggers.
Oh, yeah. God. She's evil. I'm not evil.
No, you're not evil, but you.
I can't play evil.
Okay, all right, we can talk more about that. All right, so you come back and you try to get started again.
But I have my degree now.
Now you have, does it help?
Yes, because then I could go pursue my second degree. So I went to Hong Kong U, and I went for my master's in comparative literature while I was doing my talk show. I stumbled on that at the same time.
Okay, talk show.
Okay,
you walked in. You walked into a radio station, and
TV,
they said,
"This was TV."
TV. Oh, talk show,
cable TV.
And you walked into a TV station, and they said, "Ah, there she is, the woman of our talk show dreams."
No. Oh. So they had a little inkling of this kind of a passé, actress who came back around, educated, but somebody. Let's try her out. We have this new women's channel. Cable was launching at the time. It was new. And so they hired me to be on the women's channel to host a talk show, a women's talk show. That was their plan. And I remember talking to my boss, the lady. I said, listen, because she wanted me to wear a suit, put my hair tied back, you know, like a nice anchor woman, very professional looking.
Sort of a Jackie Chan kind of personality.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Not. So I tell her, lady, I don't own a suit, and I don't think I look good with my hair back. And she says, well, I'll let you wear what you're comfortable with, and we'll go with it and see how it works. So I wore my mini skirts and flip-flops and tank tops and
whatever I wanted
to wear. But it was, I guess, by nature.
Had you done this before?
No, ever, never.
Oh, I want to talk about how you entered into that world.
Well, because of that opportunity, default.
Yeah,
they just
said,
just be a host of this woman's channel. They thought I was just some generic woman's host.
Yeah.
And I couldn't fit the mold. I said, you have to give me my own thing. And she was nice enough to do that. And then soon after they started bringing on these women's topics, they realized I had more of a mouth than I thought to.
Not the quiet, demure-looking person.
No, and I couldn't sit still. And if there are things that required opinions, I would shoot them out. And sometimes I would say the wrong things.
Going Using back, those words.
That's right. That's right.
See, it was all for a reason.
I guess so. You want to hear a good example?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so I don't know if I should. So we have.
If you have a young child watching this, you
thank
know.
You. The radio show taught me to do that. I had to do that because a lot of times we talked about sexual issues were not appropriate for families, even though I think it's healthy.
This is the internet. It's healthy.
Okay, so I can swear.
It, only in Cantonese.
Do you know what? No, I won't do that to you. Can you swear?
Not in Cantonese, but I can in English.
In Japanese?
In Japanese, I'm afraid not. In French?
In Jewish.
Yiddish.
That's not swearing.
Well, why don't you use Yiddish for this discussion?
What do you think I am? Later. I'll think of something.
Okay, so here we are.
So at this, you know, this going back to the stuntmen is they used to tell me rude things like, all right, so let's get to it. My topic, this one specific show, was about masturbation. Every Friday we had sex talk, and it's a live show, okay? No time for anything. And I was with a guest, and it was very appropriate. We're just talking about why and how and things. We had a doctor on. But I didn't know the proper term for masturbation. I think the topic was something else, maybe. And all I learned was the equivalent to the slang, jerking off, in Chinese, which I can say in Chinese is da fei ge. Da fei ge, if you translate it, means to hit the airplane.
Da fei ge.
Oh, see?
Write that down.
Now, when I said that, there was silence in the panel because they couldn't believe I said that live. And I didn't know what the heck I said wrong. And I just sat there, and the guests sat there. And then, of course, the censorship the next day slapped us with a little warning.
Oh, no kidding.
But then after that, we got like tabloid, we got like front news. You know, the media loved me. They're like, oh, what's she going to say next? So it became a very top-rated show. People were tuning in. It's like, oh, this lady's talking about jerking off on live TV. So, you know, there are little stories like that that kind of kept my show going.
I guess
and it
so.
It was all legit, though. I wasn't trying to be.
It could happen here right now, too. Already it could happen, you know.
What? Jerking off? You see?
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 Come, I can
this
see
is
the,
not
the,
good.
The phones are lighting up.
But that's the thing. I found that sexuality was a topic that many people found very uncomfortable with, but many people wanted to talk about it. There was a real kind of a lack of that area, and I felt
is that cultural?
Yes, of course. You know, and before my show, nobody would talk about this on the show, unless it was a sleazy show and they're talking about it with, like, we had a hot tub talk show where they had these girls in bikinis sitting with these two horny guys talking about stuff, and it was so tacky. It's just, you know, so they have that extreme. But mine was all clean. We're just talking about what happens in life.
Okay, what we're going to do now is we're going to go to a break. And during the break, Crystal and I are only going to talk about clean things.
Okay.
So you won't have to worry that you're missing anything. We'll be back. We'll get right on the track in 1 minute.
Aloha and welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii. I am Ina Chang. I am the guest host for Small Business Hawaii with Reg Baker. Tune in every Thursday at 2 p.m. and watch us. Aloha.
Aloha. My name is Richard Emery, host of Condo Insider. More than a third of Hawaii's population live in some form of association, and our show is all about educating board members and owners about their responsibilities and obligations and providing solutions for a great association. You can watch me live on Thursdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each week. Aloha.
Aloha, this is Maria Mera, and I'm here to invite you to my bilingual show, Viva Hawaii on ThinkTech Hawaii, every other Monday at 3 p.m. We're here to inform, motivate, and entertain you. Join us. Hola, soy Maria Mera, y estoy aquí para invitaros a mi show bilingüe, Viva Hawaii en ThinkTech Hawaii, cada dos lunes a las 3 de la tarde. Estamos aquí para informaros, motivaros y entreteneros. Apuntaros.
Bingo, I lied. It was not clean. You should have been there. Okay, tell us some more, but tell us nicely.
What?
Huh. What happened with your television show?
What happened to it? Well, it went on for a few years.
Yeah.
I got married.
Did it go down the same track?
Well, so it had its run for, I'd say, two, you know, it was a daily show, so it was quite exhausting, live. At the time, I was dating my husband. Nighttime, 10 o'clock, at the Star Ferry. You ever see, it's a famous spot in Hong Kong, and the backdrop was the Star Ferry, so it was beautiful.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
You're dating your husband? Yes. I'm jealous already, I'm telling you now.
Well, he probably doesn't really miss those times, because he used to pick me up after work to take me on a date, and this was 11 o'clock p.m., and he works in banking, so he's up at like 4 or 5 in the morning for the trade, right? So the things you do when you're still, But yeah, I had some fun topics because the type of guests that came in, for example, transgender, that's something current here. We would have a transgender, I know, on the news, everywhere. But in those days, it wasn't news. And, you know, transgender in Hong Kong was like triple taboo, right?
Yeah.
And she, this woman would come on and talk about her life, and I would dig into graphic details, and I think people were interested.
Yeah, I'm sure.
In fact,
because they weren't getting it anywhere else.
No,
that's the
you're
thing.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody talks about it, but people want to know, right? That's the thing.
Sure.
And at the end, she was so proud of her body, she wanted to show it to me.
Yeah.
And it was like the last few seconds, and it was just credit rolling.
Don't answer that. I just now here we are. We're on this successful talk show.
Okay.
One of the points of success is that you talk candidly, you talk about sex, use, you know, the vernacular words for
proper
sex things.
Mm-hmm.
And now there's this woman with you, and she's proud of her body, and she tells you on the air, she tells you, Crystal, I feel like I ought to show you my body, okay?
Yeah.
You think we should take another break? No.
So what does she do? She lifts her top. The cameraman was about to, like, you know, have a heart attack. And she wanted me to feel her breasts. She was so proud of it. It was so funny, you know? That was
what
all
kind of
it.
Calls did you get on that one?
Well, you know, not as many calls as when we talked about extramarital affairs, because people were more interested in, because they could identify. Transgender, they'd just be watching and going, freak, you know, weird stuff, you know. But when we talked about mistresses, that was a big one. Guys would call in and say, you know, yeah, I have a mistress, it's just such a pain, but I can't get out of it, and we're like, you know.
That's great stuff, because in China, you know, there's so many, it's a
it's
cultural
true.
Thing again,
exactly.
Right? You can have more than one, you got two families.
Right, oh yes.
Some people do,
sure.
Important people do.
Oh yeah.
And we're not talking about just, you know, an affair, we're talking about a whole family life,
yeah.
A whole generation, sort of a split in the family, this family, that family.
Yeah.
You know, so they have problems, they have issues, it's like a sitcom.
Yeah, a bad one.
And a bad one, but they can call you and talk to you, and it's all anonymous.
Yeah, so some of them,
and you can answer them, give them a reality test,
Would that work here? Are there mistresses here?
Well.
You can't step on people's toes here.
You know,
here
I got all these great lines to, you know, to take breaks, but I don't want to take the break.
You just had a break. You don't need a break.
No, but a break's been a cliffhanger. You give me all these cliffhangers.
Oh.
Does that work here? Well.
Well, you know, why waste time, right?
Let's get right down to it.
Hour.
So you gave him advice about what to do and not
do? No. I'm not Dr. Ruth by any chance. I am a host. My job is to draw things out of people and have candid conversations and hopefully inspire people to, you know, to provoke thought. That's my thing. I don't try to be sensational. It just comes out that way sometimes. And people want to hear the truth behind what people do.
Sure they do. They want to hear things that nobody else talks about.
That's right.
That's one of our little principles here. You know, the pockets of activity, knowledge, events, experience that nobody talks about.
That's
we
right.
want to talk about
okay.
them.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So where do I come in on that?
I guess you can come right in. What was the, you know, who supports a show like this? The station sponsors? And how did they feel? How did the government feel? Mm. I mean, what did you have, you know, people who swore by you, stopped you in the street, said, "Hi, Crystal,
oh,
I know you."
A lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's a small community, and people who did watch it, watched it, you know, religiously. And I remember one time, this was like quite a long time after the show, but this boy, this young teenager says, "Oh, my mom used to watch a show. She would make me go in my room when the show was on." So it was quite tender. It was cute. You know, they remember me for being that talk show host.
Yeah, but it's an attitudinal thing.
Yeah, so
in other words, you got by the taboos.
Labeled.
You were having fun, you smiled. This was all very...
I talked about all the wrong things, but people loved it.
Yeah, sure. And if you hadn't been American, it wouldn't have been the same, right?
I think you're right.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to use that, but sure. You know, I mean, not all Americans are candid and opinionated, but yes, most are. but yes, I mean, they saw me differently. I don't think they considered me local, so in a way I had more freedom to work.
Yeah.
I could get away with wearing jeans to a banquet when it wasn't appropriate. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, she's
a special
just
persona.
ABC girl.
Did you make tons of money?
No.
Sorry.
That's the one thing. Ask my husband, ask my friends. I don't know why. You know, talk show hosts don't make tons of money, but, you know.
Oh, I can tell you that.
Oh, okay. Oh, what? There's no money in this? Well, why am I here?
I don't know. Let's try to figure that out sometime.
Yeah.
And bring the psychologists in. Yeah.
Get a bunch of sponsors in. Yeah, I never learned how to make money. I had a radio show, which made even less money. The last one I did for the last couple of years was the government radio. You know how much they pay.
Government radio, my God, they always have an agenda, don't they?
Well, that's the thing. They're like, how did you get away with a show like that?
You got away with this on government radio?
Uh-huh. And my show then was called The Sex Crystals. That was even more specific. You know, let's get down to it.
We're not going to name this show The Sex Crystals.
No?
No.
You don't like it? It's kind of
I love it, but we're not going to name it that. Borders, boundaries.
But that was in English, the government radio show. That was an English channel.
But everybody in Hong Kong speaks English, huh?
Yeah, but there's two different communities. You're either local, you watch local channels, or you're expat.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I did both. And so I didn't get to have the excuse of saying something wrong on the English show.
So you were on the Chinese show.
So I did, my TV show was, I had
Cantonese,
a previous
radio
show
was Chinese.
And you're
appealing to the Cantonese community.
That's right, right.
And the government didn't care so much about that.
Well, the government later on when I did that for the English show, it's a smaller market, you know.
Yeah.
I did get in trouble for that one once. I had a vagina week. Because I was in a play called The Vagina Monologues.
Yeah, sure.
We did the Cantonese version, which is a funny one, too, because, you know, in Hong Kong on TV, you're not allowed to say the word vagina.
Well, I mean, it's a taboo around here, too. You know, people do not walk down the street having a conversation about that. Yeah.
Right. But people have heard of The Vagina Monologues. And it's a proper name. It's in the dictionary.
In New York, it's not a problem at all for some reason. You know, they make a Broadway play and invest millions
in it. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's right. And it's not a slang. It's just every girl has one.
It's anatomy is what it is.
Exactly. Yeah. It's a body part. And we couldn't say the word when we were promoting the show. So when we were interviewed on TV shows, we couldn't say it. And they had they had to find a slang, like a cute name. And they put it VV.
VV. And that's the way you say it in Cantonese.
Yeah, so Cantonese girls, so you go, hey, VV. They can't even say V, it's wee. You know, they don't say the V. They go, wee, wee, and that means you're a little...
I thought it meant something else, but hey, that's all right.
Well, see, you're okay. Maybe to you. I told you, slangs can go.
Let's go back for a minute and unpack the thing about the vagina monologue. How did you get involved in that? You were in the show, Broadway show, on a tour,
or so I forgot
recreated in Hong Kong?
I forgot to mention that I did do plays. I studied theater. So during the time in my film and TV talk show career time, I would stage small productions. You know, I would write and produce and and direct little small plays. And so they did the first Cantonese version of this. This is a quite a big local production company, theatrical, and they brought me in because I had the mouth. They wanted images of strong women who spoke. So they got three different personas to do that one.
And you were one of them. And you were natural because everybody knew you were already by that time.
Yes, but do you know how hard it is to speak a monologue in Chinese when it's not your first language?
Hard.
And all the words, the vagina words in Chinese, is just...
I personally have a lot of trouble doing that.
Do you? Right? Get it.
So what did you say when you made your monologue? What did you talk about?
No, well, it was all written.
This is out of the Broadway.
The vagina monologues was, we had the rights, we had to do the exact same. It was just translated.
Okay.
Set to memorize the actual.
Was it popular? Did you make money on that?
A little bit, paid rent, yeah. But, you know, it was a good run, yeah. I had 10 shows each time. We did like three runs. So it was good.
Very cool.
I couldn't talk to my kids about it. At that time, my kids were very young, and I'd come home after my show with flowers and gobs of makeup on, and I couldn't tell them what I was doing.
But what have you been doing, Mommy? I'm sorry, we can't discuss that.
Only now they kind of, you know.
You know, when you have a TV, we'll talk about radio too.
Yeah.
Radio and a show.
Right.
All those things like connect, right?
Absolutely.
And it's geometric progression. They all build, and after a while, each one reinforces the popularity of the other. You must have been getting pretty popular now.
Well, you know, it was stable and it was fun. And you build on it. So like for my radio show, I would like to make it more visual. And I requested to have some kind of, if I had a cook, a chef here, we would have him bring in the bread and we would be slapping it around and talking and trying to make it more visual with an extra dimension.
Here?
That was in Hong Kong.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Can I do that here?
No.
Aw.
Oh, look at the studio.
Well, yeah.
I don't do bread in here.
There's always a first
cooking show.
No, we didn't cook. Oh, I had a cooking show too. When I was pregnant, my talk show, my last part of the talk show turned into, get this, the title was Food, Sex, and Cyrstal Kwok. And that was one of my huge.
It
was huge. And I would pick a topic that was, see, this is where they're trying to use me. At this point, when they knew that I was going to talk about anything, they used my name and said, let's talk about something. Let's just talk about that. But bring in food. So if we talked about foreplay, for example, that's a topic, I would bring in, we would talk about appetizers. And my guests, we would share thoughts on appetizers and prepare it. And then we'd get into the analogy of foreplay. So
appetizer, I got it.
Yeah, right?
This is good. This is really emancipated stuff. So people were learning.
Yes,
they thinking. You know, I mean, it's not that the world of Susie Wong, you know, everybody is sexually conscious and all this and educated. No, that's not necessarily so. Your show was an educational experience for everybody.
I think it was. Yeah. I hope so.
Yeah. But they loved that. And it drew them. And aside from the humor of it and the candor of it, it was also a lesson. Yeah.
I hope. Because there is a need for people to talk about these issues, because Chinese people in particular and Japanese are very self-conscious about their bodies just because of the culture.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean things don't exist underneath, and if you don't talk about it, and these kids, one time we talked about women on top.
I think I got it.
What? No, you don't get it.
No, it's okay. We're going to take another break now.
No. Do we have to?
We're going to take a break, and we're going to come back. We're
going
to find out
what
women on top really means.
Okay. Hi, I'm Donna Blanchard. I'm the host of Center Stage here on ThinkTech. This show is so very dear to my heart. We talk with artists of various different ilk here about the process that they go through for their art. So we talk about what they're doing, why they are doing it, how they do it. It's a show that is inspiring. This is what I hear from people all the time. And a show that will teach you something, sometimes something about yourself. I hope you'll join us. The show is Center Stage. It's on ThinkTech every Wednesday at 2 o'clock. We'll see you then.
Aloha! How you doing? It's me, Angus McTech, wishing you to welcome and join us to see us on Hibachi Talk on ThinkTech Hawaii. Join my co-hosts, Gordo the Tech Czar and Andrew the Security Guy, every Friday from 1300 to 1345. We look forward to seeing you. We'll talk tech and we'll have some wee bit of fun. And remember, let your wing gang free wherever you be. Aloha!
One, bingo! We're back, we're live. We're here at the 10 o'clock rock with Cyrstal Kwok. And we're calling this show Kwok Talk.
You like that?
On ThinkTech Global, because it is global, you know. I mean, most of what we talked about is the comparison of cultures, you know. I call it cultural arbitrage, where you know one and you know the other, and then you bring them together. And there's a real value. It's an added, it's a plus thing, yeah.
Yes, absolutely, especially
That's
here
what
in
you
Hawaii.
Were doing, yeah.
Yeah. Lots of layers.
Yeah. Okay, like so let's talk about the women on the top.
See,
now.
I thought you were going to forget.
No, no, you could run away, but I'm going to remember that one.
You want to know.
You can't hide
See?
On that one.
All right. So the topic was, women on top. And again, we had a doctor on, well, I actually had a co-partner who always talked about those issues. But more importantly is one lady called to express thanks for our show and that topic, because she's been married for like over 10 years and she never had a climax. And after we had that one topic that explained that the position of a woman that can straddle, I guess you could say, she was ecstatic. She's, thank you. Thank you. She had no idea. So going back to the education.
And the gratification.
And gratification. That's
your
a bonus.
Gratification.
No pun intended.
Her gratification leads to your gratification.
Right.
Okay.
Well, I don't really even think about it. I don't feel like I'm thanked. You know, it doesn't matter. But it showed that how conservative and ignorant people were about their bodies and the lack of communication with their partners. And that's why we bring it to the table.
Yeah. You will never know how many people were just like her, had the same experience,
sure.
and didn't call in.
Right.
You know, I mean, you could have changed the cultural mores in Hong Kong, which has, what, 5 million people or something?
Six?
Yeah. Okay. And you wouldn't, well, you could guess, but you wouldn't know for sure.
Well, that's why there's a lot of things out there, you know, you don't know about.
Well, I mean, when you talk like this, talk about things they don't want to talk about.
Yeah.
It opens up a whole new world of communication, doesn't it?
Yes.
And it's not just sex. It's not
no,
just these
absolutely
things.
Not.
It's everything.
Sure.
It's talking truth.
Yeah.
You know, and I know it sounds crazy, but one of the things I think people like about Donald Trump.
Oh, God.
Sorry. Yeah. Break? No.
Because he's true. He's honest.
He may be wrong. He is wrong.
Yeah.
But he's telling you how he feels.
Right,
and
right.
some people resonate with that.
Well,
know?
But then he should have a freaking talk show, not be a president, because it's just
two
different
things.
He used
to have a talk show. It was bad.
Yeah. I told, if he wins, I'm moving back to Hong Kong.
A lot of people are saying that about a lot of places in the world. There's one website in Texas where they're looking to match you up with a partner in Canada who will take care of you when you move to Canada after the election.
That's great. That's great. Yeah, yeah. No, what's going on here? No.
Okay, so tell us how you got into radio now, per se. Because television first,
yeah.
movies on
Actually,
the side.
Actually, television and radio came at the same time. When
okay.
I was on a roll, I had both. So on the weekends, I'd work at this one radio station, and then every day I would have my talk show. So it kind of, I did both, and I was actually doing everything. I was studying my second degree, and I was writing a script for my film. That's another story, because I got this information from what I've seen in Hong Kong. I was fascinated by the world of mistresses, because coming from the States, being clean and just, you know, schooled and not thinking that the world is really that
more complex.
Yeah. I was just like, I was obsessively fascinated by why women choose to be the other woman and why men choose to have this double life with the pain that comes with it.
Yeah.
And I
and
met
risk, huge risk.
Yes, yeah. but they'll do it, right?
Yeah,
you know,
do
it's
it.
Just the nature.
Yeah.
And I had a roommate at the time who was a English teacher who had an extra job to teach a tutor someone, she got this ad. She went to the interview, found out it was a mainland mistress, a Chinese mistress from the mainland. And the guy was there and just gave her a wad of cash on the first day after the interview, saying, okay, just start tutoring her. She wants to learn some English. And so she would come home telling me about this village girl who was living in this mansion, who had all the money to play with, and she's just like, what's going on? So I decided to write a screenplay about this uneducated mistress who had everything to work with, and this educated Asian American westernized Chinese girl who thought she had everything, but she kind of was curious about that side. So it's kind of like two different worlds flipping and knowing that it doesn't really work out the way you think it's going.
It doesn't work out.
No.
In the story about the girl from the village.
Yeah, Google them. It's called The Mistress, my film. And it's it was an award-winning film. I put 5 years into it.
Is that right? Wow.
That's my biggest pleasure, is to be a director, a filmmaker.
So the talk show stuff is just... They get together. This happens with the water cash and the...
So she develops a close friendship with the girl. They become friends. They go out.
Yeah.
But they end up slowly switching places. Because the village girls, like, learning how to be a modern cosmopolitan girl, she's taking in all the ways to be successful, to be independent. The other girl's like, wow, curious. You're going to be, you know, this sexual partner for this guy. And she's just going on with all these crazy thoughts. And so it's an interesting study of women's positions.
How's it end, if you can tell me?
I'm not telling you. You have to watch it. Oh. I'll give you the...
Okay, the name again?
The Mistress.
That's so interesting. My niece is a filmmaker.
Oh.
Okay. And she wrote a film called A Teacher, which got onto Netflix and all this, and won something in Sundance and Paris and all that. And it's kind of similar. It's about a young woman teacher and a kid who was a junior or senior in high school.
Right.
Her kid, her student, and how they, you know, get it on.
Uh-huh.
And it comes in the middle. I don't know what yours does, but it comes in the middle. In other words, you don't see a romance. You just see it when it begins to start crumbling.
Oh, interesting.
And the story is the story of how it crumbles.
Oh.
And you cover the crumble, huh?
I cover the fantasy and then the crumble.
Yeah.
There's a lot of fantasy in it.
Yeah.
We had a shot of this fantasy of this naked woman's body that was tattooed. You know how he was tattooed all over her body? Because I heard once that in Japan, you should ask your wife, is people eat sashimi off of naked bodies. You know, when you have like a kinky kind of a
party. We don't
party.
Do that at home.
No?
No.
Oh, darn. It's to you. Warm. You don't want warm sushi, right? So.
You heard it here on ThinkTech. You are learning so much. I hope you're writing at least some of this down.
Yeah, it's all cultural research, right?
Okay, so, you know, you're riding high on this. You've got it all going. You know, they must stop you all the time in the street now. You can't walk a block without somebody saying, Cyrstal Kwok, I know you. Then you decide to come back, or come back to the U.S., come to Hawaii. But tell us the story of that.
Well, it's not so interesting. It's because, you know, sometimes I have three kids. They're growing up. I believe that they need to have some education here, have a little more freedom, a little more natural life, because Hong Kong's become very polluted. I call it the three O's. Mm-hmm. It's overpolluted, overpopulated, and overpriced. I really think it's kind of crazy.
That picture behind us is kind of an example.
Yeah, you feel claustrophobic. It's crazy. Yeah. Everything's on top of each other. And it's great for that reason. But sometimes you need a little fresh air.
Yeah.
Some beautiful mountains.
So it was a simple, rational decision to come
actually,
back.
No. It was not rational. We just pulled out. We pulled the roots without even thinking. Because my boys like to surf. We've been traveling out here during vacation time to surf. And we've always wanted to move out here. And strangely enough, my husband got a job out here, and we said, that's the ticket.
That's the ticket.
And
that's
we left, like, literally right away.
Yeah, and you didn't mind giving all the notoriety up.
Because I believe there's a time and place for everything, and you move somewhere, and you make that work. Right?
You believe in chapters.
Yes, I do. I do.
And you have to be able to have the courage, the cojones, maybe. That's a Chinese word, by the way. it's a California word, anyway.
Uh-huh.
to see the next chapter and to move to the next chapter and not to hesitate, to know when it's time.
Yeah, but you don't see it. You just have to take that dive, I think.
Go on intuition, on gut.
Yeah, because everybody plays it too safe. A lot of people like to plan things, and life's too short to just, you know, you want to just be thrown into something.
Yeah.
And if you take that chance with conviction and confidence,
yeah,
you'll make it work.
Yeah, but sometimes it could be wrong. then could be a mistake. What happened then?
Then maybe that was that chapter, and then that you spin off of that one. Yeah, and then you spin off, and where that takes you, wherever you're supposed to go next.
Yeah,
right?
Whether it be back or forward.
Yeah,
but it's next.
Yeah. It's still
That's
going
a great
forward.
Philosophy.
It's fun
to be young and free.
Well, I am neither of those,
neither young, but
it's okay. I'm happy.
I'm doing the math here.
Yeah? Did you see? Did they say how old I was here? I turned 50 2 days ago.
No, you're kidding.
Yeah, congratulate me.
That's not true. That's not everything up to
you gotta,
this
like,
point.
Congratulate
I
me. And I got my tattoo last year in Taiwan for my 49th birthday.
Okay.
That's it. I'm done. I did it.
That's fabulous. Okay, doing well.
So I got no secrets.
So now you come back.
Yeah.
What are you gonna do?
I would like to have a platform similar to my old Hong Kong days to discuss, because I do believe it's an international thing. People want to talk about issues. I want to raise issues that are, whether it's social, personal, private, antisocial, I don't care, but something that brings something to the table that inspires thought and discussion. I think that's really important and healthy.
Yeah. Now, how did you get your guests in Hong Kong for all these shows you did? And is that process going to be similar here?
That's what I'm worried about, Jay, because in those days at cable, they would bring on all the guests for me. They'd bring in big, hot celebrities, and some of them hated me because I would ask them questions they didn't want to talk about. Like, oh, gay issues. Like, oh, you're gay? And they're like, what? You're not supposed to say that on, you know. And
wish
they would
I was
hate
there.
Me. But I guess here I'm going to have to scramble. I'm going to have to, like, pull some...
We can help you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to stay in touch with the community, and you have to, you know, leapfrog a network and all those things.
Yeah, I'll figure it out.
They know how to do that in Hong Kong, too.
That's true.
It's a matter of
It's just a small community,
people.
Too.
Yeah.
But it's fun, so people should want to come in and discuss this. I'd like to have a woman's circle and talk about women's issues that are really important, that are lacking.
Yeah. So, how can you talk about women's issues here in a way that comports with the local shtick? That's another Chinese word, shtick.
Is it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Just like schmuck? Schmuck. Yeah, sounds very Chinese. Yeah. Yes, because, again, you're talking about layering, and what's the word you used before when you're combining two elements? Well, anyway, it's the same thing. You know, you first have a social issue. That's the universal topic. Then you have women's issues, and then you have people from different places. I'd like to have the local outlook on it, but with an Asian twist, because you want to have new perspective coming in on, okay, so here, this is how we feel about this problem. And then we bring in something from my background in Asia. And so we can
arbitrage.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, it comes up again. It's like you had a California, you know, mainland kind of view of things, and you bring that to Hong Kong, put it together, and now you've got a cultural arbitrage. Well,
yes.
We do the same thing here. It's not the same arbitrage, though, because
no.
This is different, and people are, in their own way, more reticent here.
Yeah.
But they also have the same curiosities.
Exactly. We're humans, and you know what? That's what I'm dealing with every day here. We're bringing a part of our old life here and learning how to adapt and to... you know, absorb and enjoy what we have here without losing that and working it out.
Well, ThinkTech is an educational organization.
I'm glad.
We're a 501c3 in the fullest extent of nonprofit.
So happy to know you exist.
Yeah, yeah.
It's great.
Well, I think we can do business here, Crystal.
Okay, that's a good thing.
Thank you so much for coming back.
Pleasure.
And bringing us your skills and your energy.
Thank you.
And let's do business going forward. You'll see more of Cyrstal Kwok, maybe at this very time and station.
Yeah.
And thank you for coming down today.
Thank you. Thank you for tuning in.
Yeah. Xie xie.
Okay.